Today I'm going to show you a few very simple but very powerful methods that you can use to improve the reliability and accuracy of your LLM outputs. And these methods really apply basically to any kind of application that you would be building, whether it's some kind of RAG system, a chatbot, classification, really any task that you would be using these language models for. And these methods I've been using myself more and more in my recent client work because, as you will see in a minute, they are just very simple to implement, giving you an easy way to just get that little boost of accuracy and reliability in your applications. And that little boost will often allow you to go past those 80%, 90% ceilings that you might often hit with just prompt engineering or improving other parts of your application, like the retrieval component in your RAG system. Then these methods will often allow you to take that into the high 90s, maybe even something close to 100% in a lot of cases. So now I'm going to first walk you through these methods conceptually with some code examples. And then I'm also going to talk about a recent real-world example from one of these client projects where I used these same methods for a relatively challenging entity recognition task with very good results. So jumping into our presentation here, a concept that's going to be central to all the things I'm going to talk about in this video is structured outputs. And this is probably familiar to quite a lot of you now, especially since structured outputs is now available directly in the OpenAI API as of last month. Before that, we were using libraries like Instructor to do this. And I still like to use Instructor, actually, one reason being that it allows you to do this seamlessly across different model providers. So whether you use OpenAI, Anthropic, or something else, with Instructor, you can get those structured outputs very seamlessly across any model you want to use. And so the idea of structured outputs, in very simple terms, to those who are not familiar with the concept, is that we can get class objects as the output of our language model calls instead of strings. And so what that looks like is that we can simply define these classes and then set those classes as the output of our language model. So instead of getting a string from this call here, we get an instance of a person with the name John Doe and an age attribute of 30. And working with these class objects is very useful in a variety of ways, as you can probably imagine. But one of the things it allows us to do is that we can then easily add validation into these classes. So continuing with our person example, we could add this kind of a simple age validation to check if age is not a negative number. And then this would raise an error if we ever tried to create a person with a negative age, or if a language model tried to extract a person entity from some text, which might happen due to some hallucination or typo in the text. But adding this kind of a validation, this kind of person would simply never go through. And that way we know that anytime we have one of these person objects, they are going to conform to some expectations that we have. And we can assume that the age is always going to be a positive number, or it could also be less than 130, something like that could also be part of the validation. Another more realistic and very useful example is for any kind of situation where you would use a language model to give an answer based on some documents, some additional context, as we do with RAG all the time, in which case you would often have the model give some references, some citations to the sources that the answer is based on. But if you've ever tried to build this kind of a system, then you would know that sooner or later the model is going to hallucinate on those citations and it's going to reference to a document or a source that doesn't actually exist anywhere. So here we could add this kind of a validation where our response model is this fact, where the fact itself is the answer given by the model and the list of references is a list of IDs to the sources or the chunks that the fact is based on. And then for that list of references, we can match that against all the known document IDs, all the IDs that are available in our context or in our database. And then if the language model returns a chunk ID or a document ID that doesn't actually exist in our database, then again, we can raise an error and we can reject that response. And the way all of this becomes even more useful is that both Instructor and the OpenAI structured outputs parameter allow us to retry these language model calls so that if any of these validations doesn't pass, then the language model is going to try again. And it's also going to try again with the previous error. So it knows why the previous response failed, for example, with a reference ID that doesn't exist. It's going to get that error message in the second attempt, and that's going to give it a better chance at not making that same mistake again. And so now to the main topic of this video, which is that although these validators can just be these simple checks in regular code, like these previous two examples, the validators themselves can also use LLMs. And so here we have a simple example of how we might check the responses of a chatbot for any rudeness. And for this, our chat response simply has this one response attribute, and this is what we would send back to our user. But we also have this validator for that field in which the generated response gets sent to this check rudeness function. And this is where we call a language model to check that response with the instructions to reject any responses that are rude. And what we get back from this rudeness check is this kind of an object that's a true or false value, indicating whether or not the response passes the validation, in which case we simply send that response to the user. But if it doesn't pass the validation, then we also have this reasoning explaining why it didn't pass the validation. And then again, we can raise an error for that, causing the chat response to fail, and try again with this error message informing the model why the previous response didn't go through. And so while this is a very simple example of doing this kind of a guardrailing for a conversational system, and you could use this same approach to reject any messages that talk about politics, that talk about competitors, anything of the sort. But really beyond chatbots and conversational systems, you can also just apply this LLM validation to check for the quality of any kind of task, any kind of output. You can check that the certain instructions have been followed correctly, that the output is formatted in the correct way. You can use it to double check the reasoning steps of a model, or checking that the model doesn't make any claims or statements that aren't backed up by some facts in the documents in the given context. Any quality checks of that nature, anything you can imagine, you can achieve with a similar approach, just adjusting the instructions that you use for this LLM validation. And so what's useful to understand here is that people have been trying some variations of this LLM validates LLM approach since the early days of GPT 3.5, but it's really only recently become much more feasible to do something like this at scale. And that's because GPT 3.5, the earliest versions, would often simply not be good enough to do a lot of these kinds of critique or validation tasks. And then on the other hand, the early versions of GPT-4 were far slower and far more expensive than the models we have now. And so then if you were building some kind of application where you used GPT-4 for generating something and then also GPT-4 for validating that response, the trade-off of latency and cost simply wouldn't be worth it in most cases, unless you really, really cared about validation and you didn't care about latency and cost. But now the beauty is that now we do have these models that are fast, super fast and cheap to the point of being basically free, like GPT-4o Mini, Claude 3 Haiku or Llama 3 running on Grok. And all of these models are also stronger models than GPT 3.5. And so what that means is that this trade-off between latency and cost no longer really applies. And it really is possible to just double check or even triple check your outputs with these efficient, fast models to catch any quality errors, basically without much downsides at all. So now I'm going to walk through some more examples in a more interactive way, so you also get a better feel for how you can actually implement these things yourself. And I will also show this real-world example from a recent project. But for starters, we are going to walk through another guardrailing example, this time looking at a sales chatbot for electric cars, for Tesla. And looking at this setup without any validation, without any guardrailing, we can see that if the user might ask something like this, asking for some similar EVs that they can compare from other companies, the model might oftentimes output something like this, where indeed it's going to list a couple of competing products. And understandably, this probably is something we don't necessarily want our sales chatbot to do. So we're going to look at how we can guardrail this kind of a system to reject these kinds of responses. And so this is going to look familiar to those previous examples I showed in the presentation, but here I'm going to walk through them in a bit more detail. And so just like before, we have this kind of a validation response, which contains both the true or false value for whether or not we accept the response, and then the reasoning behind that. And then for this validation function, we are using the fastest and cheapest Anthropic model, Claude 3 Haiku, so that this validation step doesn't add too much latency to our chat system. And then down here is our prompt with our instructions on how to manage this validation. The instructions themselves are very simple, and a model like GPT-4o or 3.5 Sonnet could probably do this validation without any examples, but as we are using this cheaper and less intelligent model, it's a very good idea to add a few examples so that even the weaker model can carry out the task correctly. So we have simple instructions and a few examples on what kinds of responses should be rejected. And then down here is our validated response as opposed to our previous simple response, which simply has the response attribute. In this no competitor response, we've added this validator to that response to run it through the validate response function using this prompt right here. And then now here we can give it a try. We can try and instantiate one of these no competitor response objects with this content, and we should be running into an error, as indeed the response mentions the Chevrolet Bolts. Now the cool thing is also that we can add here all kinds of validations in this single object. We could add another LLM validation just using a different prompt, for example, to prevent the bot from ever giving any special discounts or deals, as with the much publicized story of the guy who bought a Chevrolet Tahoe for $1 using a chatbot on the company website. And then we can also add these kinds of deterministic checks, for example, to see that the responses aren't too long. So we could do all of this together. And just to show that, we're going to set the length to be very low. And so then let's try this with a response that should pass these first two validations. We'll also rename this actually, validate no deals. And now if we change this into, let's say, Tesla Model 3 has great mileage, this should pass the no competitor check as well as the special discounts, but it is going to fail the maximum length being more than 10 characters. So let's give this a go. And indeed, that's exactly what happens. And then finally, we'll just get rid of these two now. We get an invalid no competitor response at first, then we can try again up to some number of times. Two should be enough. And then here, the end result is that even if we use the same exact message as we did at the start of our notebook, this time we should certainly not get any competitors in the response, like so. Okay, so now finally for this real world example of how I've used this kind of LLM validation with a recent client. And this project was about analyzing customer service calls by feeding the call transcripts into a language model to do all kinds of analysis to understand what are the reasons why people call customer service, as well as just identifying at a more granular level ways to improve the service. And so one of the things we also did in this project, because this was a client working in a highly regulated industry, we also wanted to clean the call transcripts before doing the analysis of any sensitive information or personally identifiable information. And aside from doing the analysis with language models, we also used them for this task, for cleaning up the transcripts. And to give you a better idea, the transcripts would look something like this, being a dialogue between the customer service agent and a customer. And then in many parts of the call, you would have these pieces of social security numbers, names, addresses, phone numbers, emails, etc. And we did get good results just by refining the prompt, so that in a lot of cases, the perfect end result would look something like this, where we have successfully removed all the sensitive information, like so. But due to just the messy nature of the real transcripts, sometimes you would have the information split across different lines just because of how the transcription works. And in these kinds of cases, the language model would sometimes miss this information and leave it there. Another kind of issue we had was when there was no sensitive information to be redacted in the transcript, in which case the language model would sometimes return this kind of a response instead of just returning the unchanged transcript as it was instructed to do in the prompt. Sometimes you would get this instead, and this was also not good. And so although we were getting very good above 90% reliability in this reduction just by working on the prompt, there still remained these kinds of corner cases that we just didn't seem to be able to get rid of. And given that it is quite an important and a sensitive task, where leaving this kind of information in the text can sometimes cause a lot of damage, we wanted to see how we could take it even further. And so we added this kind of a LLM validation step to double check the reduction results with instructions that were also much more complicated or elaborate in the real case than this one here. But in a nutshell, the idea was to validate if the transcript has correctly been redacted, if there's any PIE found, or if the transcript is otherwise invalid or truncated, as in this example here, then this LLM validation would reject that response and hopefully try again with better results. And indeed, it really did work really nicely in this case. And so just to run these examples, if we run this validation against this first example where the reduction has been done perfectly well, then that is going to pass the validation like so. Whereas if we try the two other ones where we do have some issues, then those are going to fail. So the second one with the phone number, partial phone number here remaining, this fails with the validation error that there is one piece of information that was not properly redacted, which is exactly the phone number. And similarly for the second one, which is not a transcript at all, then this also gets caught by the validation as it appears to be a statement about the absence of PII rather than an actual transcript. So it works exactly as intended. And so hopefully that helps highlight this idea that I mentioned a few times in this video, which is that whether it's some kind of chatbot, guardrailing, or really any kind of task from classification or redacting sensitive information, where you simply have some instructions that the model is supposed to follow, and sometimes it fails to do so, this kind of double checking, this kind of extra validation of checking if those instructions have been followed correctly is something you can often consider as a way to improve your system. So that's all for this video. Hope you found it useful, and I'll see you next time.